Namaste. A very good morning to all of you. And we are attending the lecture series on Introduction to Western Philosophy. And Dr. Mariano Iturbe is teaching us and he is guiding in very beautiful manner. So I hope you all are enjoying the lectures. And we really look forward to this lecture series and to gain more and more knowledge through this lecture series. So I welcome you all. And I request now Dr. Mariano Iturbe to please start with his session. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Rudraksha. A very good morning to all of you who have already joined the Zoom group today for this third lecture on Introduction to Western Philosophy. Some of you already expressed it in the chat, your desire to eagerness to attend this third lecture on this important topic that is Plato and his legacy. So we are today on the third, so we are moving throughout the centuries. We started with the Presocratics, founders of Western philosophy in the 7th, 6th century BC. Then we move into the Sophists, those itinerant teachers who shifted the focus from mainly from an interest on the origin of the world to human being, followed by the great Socrates, who turned philosophy from cosmology or philosophy of nature to ethics, anthropology, and we know how the message of Socrates, a person who has not written anything, has transpired through an entire history of philosophy. And today we come to Plato. Just let me share the PowerPoint also. Okay. So Plato, no? Born in 428 or 27 BC, died 348, 47 BC. And I would like to introduce this lecture on Plato, quoting what an author in the Stanford Encyclopedia of Philosophy wrote in his own entry about Plato, because it's quite a significant, this quotation. And we can go a little bit slowly over it. It says, Plato is, by any reckoning, one of the most dazzling writers in the Western literary tradition, and one of the most penetrating, wide-ranging, and influential authors in the history of philosophy. So we are dealing with a person who, not just by the person, the source of this quotation, but by the entire Western civilization, Western philosophy, Eastern philosophy also have recognized as a figure in the history of Western philosophy, this dazzling writer, impressive writer, who has given us a most penetrating, wide-ranging, and influential approach to philosophy. An Athenian citizen of high status, he displays in his work his absorption in the political events and intellectual movements of his time. He belongs to a very aristocratic family, Plato, and he was a person very much involved in the day-to-day life of his city, Athens. But the questions he raises are so profound, and the strategies he uses for tackling them so richly suggestive and provocative, that educated readers of nearly every period have in some way been influenced by him, and in practically every age there have been philosophers who count themselves Platonists in some important respect. So Plato's legacy is present in every period of history of philosophy. So his teaching then presented are harmonized with different systems, but really are present in the entire history of, of philosophy. Of course, he was not the first thinker or writer to whom the word philosopher should be applied. But he was so self-conscious about how philosophy should be conceived and what its scope and ambitions properly are. And he so transformed the intellectual currents with which he grappled that the subject of philosophy, as it is often conceived, and this we spoke in the first class, no? That not everything is philosophy, but philosophy is something rigorous, systematic, and this rigorous and systematic examination of ethical, political, metaphysical, epistemological issues are present in Plato. Few other authors in the history of Western philosophy approximate him in depth and range. Perhaps only Aristotle, Aquinas, and Kant would be generally agreed to be of the same rank, unquote. Okay, this is an opinion of the author of an entry, but it's interesting how in the 25 centuries of history of Western philosophy, he puts on the same level, on the summit of philosophers, Plato, Aristotle, Aquinas, Kant. Plato, 5th and 4th century BC, Aristotle, 4th century BC, Aquinas, 13th century of Common Era, Kant, 18th century. So, this quotation that I have just shared with you from the Stanford Encyclopedia of Philosophy is quite accurate, and it paves the way to the study of Plato. Of course, a study that will be limited, necessary. We have 2 hours, and this is not a course on Plato. This is an introduction to Western philosophy, just to mention at least the tip of the iceberg. But just to prove that what the statement of this quotation that I have just read to all of you is not an exaggeration, there is the famous oft-repeated quotation by the British philosopher Alfred Whitehead. Alfred Whitehead is a representative of the founder of the process philosophy, who said the famous quotation that says, "The safest general characterization of the European philosophical tradition is that it consists of a series of footnotes to Plato." Again, these are phrases we have many authors, but just to underline the importance of this philosopher and to be aware that we are in front of an awesome thinker, people who have received particular talents, unrepeatable in history. A person who managed to transmit his ideas through dialogues in an attractive and appealing way. We can say Plato was 100% educator, was 100% a teacher, and proof of that was not only the way of teaching, his dialogues and his dialectic method together with Socrates, but also that he was the founder of a school, the Academy. Plato was also in the history of Greek philosophy, the second of the great trio, with Socrates preceding him, Aristotle, his disciple. So Socrates, Plato, Aristotle, the greatest trio of Greek philosophy, the three who laid the foundations of Western culture. And when we analyze all his teaching in his dialogues, we find that his interest dealt with logical issues, epistemological issues, metaphysical issues, mathematics, but the underlying motivation is always ethical. So for Plato, philosophy has to help us to be better human beings. For Plato, philosophy has to help that our societies are better places for human beings to grow and to mature and to evolve. That is the main. So it's not the main interest. Philosophy for Plato is not just an speculative exercise. It is a means to improve, a path to go up and up in our human life. he's a rationalist, so he always tried to give rationalistic, logical answers to all his questions. Occasionally, he's a mystic. We will see, for instance, the famous myth of the cave, the allegory of the cave. And Plato was born in Athens, so he's a person who was born in Athens and died in Athens, so really was a product of the Athenian civilization and culture. He was born in the year 428. It's not exactly because I was 27 or 25, but approximately around those years. So was that at that time the Peloponnesian War, remember, was the war between Athens and Sparta mainly. So it was a war to assert the hegemony over Greece after they have ended temporarily the battle against the Persians. Then there was an internal war and was known as the Peloponnesian War, and it lasted almost 30 years, from the year 431 to 404. So all the childhood and teenagers years and the youth of Plato went together with the Peloponnesian War between Athens and Sparta, mainly. Also, when he was born, around those years, Pericles died during a plague. Pericles, the great statesman, the founder of the Athenian democracy, and that affected the stability of Athens, that shifted from democracy to tyranny and invasions, and it lost quite a lot the reputation that had till that time. And during his life, we politically, historically, we see the rise of Macedonia in the north of Greece, the rise of Philip II, the father of Alexander the Great, who began to establish the Macedonic hegemony over Greece, and eventually they will conquer the entire Persian Empire. So, well, this was the period, historical and political, in which Plato lived. As I said, he was the founder of the Academy, okay, one of the most ancient institutions in the West. And originally, the Academy, from there comes the word academics, academies. Why it was Academy is not very clear. Perhaps the owner of that land, his name was Academus. There are different theories. But what is true is that in the contemporary, in modern languages like English, Spanish, Portuguese, Italian, the word Academy entered from this institution founded by Plato. Originally, the interest, what was taught in the Academy, was mainly mathematics, natural sciences, philosophy. But for 2.5 centuries, the Academy, so much many years after the death of Plato, remained as a center of culture. We can say a place that guided the research of many philosophers, even though there was a certain evolution towards skepticism. And then for some centuries, the importance of the Academy didn't disappear, but lost quite a lot its importance. Then there was a restarting during the time of the Neoplatonics in the third and fourth and fifth century of this AD. And finally, the Academy was closed in the year 529. By the Roman Emperor Justinian. And that emblematic year, 529, when the Academy is closed, is considered the day in which ancient Western philosophy come to an end and begins medieval philosophy. So it was absolutely, completely linked to the life of the Academy. So Plato owed his philosophical commitment to Socrates. We already spoke last Thursday about Socrates and all the trial, his accusation that he was an irreverent person who neglected the deity's of the city and a person who was corrupting the youth, but two unfounded charges that led him to die, but at the same time led him to be the foundation of Western philosophy. So Plato inherited that love for philosophy and that love for ethics. He was a disciple of Socrates in his youth. If Socrates died in the year 399, well, Plato was 25, 28, 29, around that age. So he was all his learning as a young student was done from what he learned from Socrates. Now, Socrates was not the only one who influenced Plato. There are others, concretely Heraclitus and Pythagoras, and together with Heraclitus, Parmenides. No? We can say Heraclitus, Parmenides, and Pythagoras. These three influenced quite a lot, but by far the one who influenced the most was Socrates. So we remember that Heraclitus distrusted on the value of the value of sensorial knowledge. The same with Parmenides. No, Parmenides developed that two ways of knowledge: the knowledge that lead us to know the one, that was our reason, our intelligence, and the knowledge that lead us to know the many, that is the knowledge provided by our senses. But the main question or the main attitude of these two authors was a certain distrust for the value of sensorial knowledge. And if we distrust our sensorial knowledge, then we end distrusting our capacity to know the truth. So that was present. And as we will see, Plato will sort out this issue by having two levels of reality: this world reality, that whatever we know here is not absolute true, and the super cosmos, no? The supracosmic knowledge, that is the knowledge about the world of ideas, as we will see later. Then the Heraclitus and Parmenides are somehow also considered like the founders of metaphysics. From the moment that they began to teach, well, this interest about being and about what remains under all changes was very much present in philosophy. So Heraclitus and Parmenides influence on Plato. Of course, he didn't meet them personally. He came to know concretely about Heraclitus through Cratylus, who was one of the disciples. In fact, one of the dialogues written by Plato is named after Cratylus or Cratylus. So, but Cratylus went one step further than Heraclitus, and he became a sort of a representative of skepticism. Really, he denied the capacity of knowing the truth to human reason. Regarding the influence of Pythagoras, again, happened the same, that it was not a direct influence in the sense that Pythagoras was previous to Plato, but especially through one of his contemporaries or disciples of Pythagoras, Archytas, Plato became acquainted with the teachings of Pythagoras. And if you remember from our first class, Pythagoras was not only a philosopher, but was a person who created a community of philosophers, a sort of a philosophical sect, if we want to call it, not with the negative meaning that nowadays have the word sect, but with that positive meaning of a school, of a group of disciples following the teachings of the master, the guru, but not only following the teachings, but also living according to those teachings. It's a sort of a style of living. So Plato absorbed this Pythagorean teaching, the importance of mathematics, and the relation with the myth of the Orpheus, that was that ancient Greek religion that has some contents like transmigration of souls, reincarnation, and also a sort of a vegetarian diet, and the interest for mathematics as we know, for Pythagoras, numbers, all things are numbers, no? And the world comes from numerical principles. So Socrates, Heraclitus, Parmenides, and Pythagoras, we can say, were the main influencers on Plato's teachings. Now we will talk a little bit about his works. Socrates has not written anything, but Plato wrote a lot. Moreover, whatever we know of Plato is contained in his dialogues. So he wrote in his style was a style, a dialogue. I mean, a question was posed and people will defend or will attack that question in order to get clarity about that topic. So that was a dialogical approach, the dialectic, as we know. In addition to these dialogues, there are some epistles, letters, that it was considered Plato wrote the 13 letters, but nowadays those 13 letters are considered that were not written by Plato, except one, the epistle number 7. So in addition to the dialogue, we can say epistle number 7, written by Plato with many interesting details about his own life. And then there are theories, because Aristotle sometimes mentioned, Aristotle was disciple of Plato, sometimes mentioned that Plato wrote not a sort of a treatise in which he exposed his own way of thinking, not in a dialogical form, but just in a systematic way, like a treatise, like any book. However, we don't have any, are completely lost if ever those writings existed. We are completely lost. There's no any manuscript, any quotation in any other philosopher later on. So we cannot count on them. We cannot work on them. So we have to focus only on the dialogues. And I have to say it is enough because the dialogues are quite rich and quite long, many of them. So the importance of the other works, I mention it because Aristotle is the one who mentioned, and Aristotle is a very authoritative source of knowledge, especially about his predecessors, concretely Plato and Socrates. So just to refresh what we spoke last class about Socrates, he is the one who developed that Socratic method of knowledge, that he called it dialectic, by questions and answers, trying to help the person to understand, to get to know the truth about various issues. And that questions and answers is an effort, no? And that is why sometimes it was compared with the task of the midwife, and it's called the midwifery method, because the teacher, by that effort that the student does, by answering questions, replying, well, adumbrate truth, reaches the truth. So the idea is to help as much as possible your students, but helping them to do whatever they can only do. Not only the student can, a teacher can repeat things, but if the student does not make the effort to assimilate, to understand, and to reach conclusions, well, the teachings, even if are given by the best philosopher in the world, will not be fruitful. That is why Plato always wanted to teach in this way, no? Helping the students to learn, to assimilate in a critical way, we can say, by questions and answers. So their effectiveness lies in the effort they demand on the part of the participants. The complete list of works of Plato originally contains 35 dialogues, plus, I said, 13 letters. Now, what happened is that throughout the centuries, it was proved that not all dialogues were authentic. And there was a distrust and, well, knowledge throughout the centuries proved that at least 6 dialogues are not authentic. That means that perhaps they transmit Plato's ideas, but were not written by him. And other set of 6 dialogues were spurious, so were written by someone else with different teachings. So this was done after comparing the teachings in one dialogue and the others, analyzing, etc., etc. Done by, and also by some stylometric, that is a methodology that has grown with the use of computer that helps to compare the style of the writing of a particular philosopher throughout the years, and you can distinguish with the help of computers whether this writing, this piece of writing belongs to you or is completely different in style, contents, etc. So nonetheless, if we remove these 12 dialogues, we remain with 23 authentic dialogues. And I said these 23 are a rich source of knowledge that are sufficient to go deeper into what Plato taught. Now, whenever you go, if you have to quote, for instance, if you have the books of Plato and you quote something said by him in a doctoral thesis or in a work, in a book, you give a particular number, no? You say Plato 252, column D, C, B, you give a particular number. Well, that number refers to an what we can call the official way of pagination, no? Of numbering the teachings of Plato. And it was done in the 16th century by a person, Henricus Stephanus. He published the complete works of Plato in three volumes in the year 1578. And then he followed a particular numbering from A to Z. And this numbering remains still today as the valid way of, and is known as the Stephanus pagination, no? The valid way of quoting. So when you quote Plato, you give that particular number, you go to the original, if you can, of this Stephanus pagination, and it will check exactly the exact quotation, the truth of that quotation. Now, when in ancient times, when the other dialogues that were not, that nowadays are not considered authentic, but when they were considered authentic, Diogenes Laertius was a biographer of Western philosopher. He lived in the third century and he wrote the first history of philosophy, and he's a good source of knowledge about the ancient philosophy, Diogenes Laertius. And Diogenes Laertius refers to Thrasyllus. Thrasyllus was the head of the academy in the first century BC, and Thrasyllus order the 36 dialogue, the list of the 36 dialogues in tetralogies, mean groups of four, no? Four, 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 nine times, 36 pieces of work. The pieces always, the 13 pieces at the time, always were considered one piece of work. But so Thrasyllus was the one who transmitted this tetralogy. And the oldest surviving manuscripts of at least half of the dialogues of Plato is the what is called a manuscript that was written in Constantinople. Constantinople is today Istanbul in Turkey. So Constantinople was the see of the Eastern Roman Empire at the time, in the year 895. And one millennium later, in the year 1809, was purchased by Oxford University, or acquired. I don't know which were the conditions, but Oxford University acquired. Now, this is interesting, no? Because, of course, the works of Plato are lost, as the works of any author from who lived and wrote 2,500 years ago, because the material of the parchments used at the time were not able to last longer. They disintegrate. So whatever we have of any ancient writer is a copy, sometimes of another copy of the original. So sometimes in this process of copying and copying and copying, mistakes can creep in, wrong translation, well, errors, no? And that is why throughout the centuries, historians compare. You can have various manuscripts and you can compare. Oh, this manuscript says A. This manuscript says B. How do we solve the problem? Which one is the true? Okay, let's compare with the third manuscript that will give us the solution, or a fourth manuscript. So it's a painstaking task, effort, done with all the great philosophers. No? But this helps us to understand why sometimes there is a lot of discussion after 2,000 years, where we say, well, what really Plato say? What really Aristotle say? Well, because of these things, no? We don't have the original writings. We have copies, and sometimes copies of other copies. But nonetheless, the enormous work done in this 2.5 millennia well, has helped us very much to reach the real content of the teachings of these great philosophers. Now, if we leave the Thrasyllus account of doing philosophy, of organizing the dialogues of Plato, these tetralogies, we go to most modern, that is to divide the dialogues according to periods in the life of Plato. The early period, the middle period, and the late period. The early period is what we can call Socratic period. So the dialogues written when Socrates was still alive. And we have these nine. The Apology, it's a beautiful book, short. I recommend you to read it. It's online available, where Socrates makes his own defense in his trial. Crito, where Plato, Socrates talks about the obedience to law. Interesting, in none of the Platonic dialogues, Plato appears talking. Socrates is always the one. So remember the Socratic problem we mentioned last time? Who was Socrates? And what did Socrates write about? Or thought of, what did Socrates think about this? Or whether it was Plato thinking? No, that divergence is the Socratic problem also. And the issue is because Socrates is the one always talking, but sometimes we say, well, this is Plato talking through Socrates, or this is clearly Socrates and Plato assimilating those ideas. No? Euthyphron, that is about piety, Laches, about courage. So you see in the dialogues very often, the topic of discussion is one virtue, one quality of life, one attitude. Ion, that is very much against the poets. Somehow Plato, at the same time that he was a great man of culture, was against some type of poetry, some type of drama, perhaps the bad influence of the Claus, the play written by Aristophanes against Socrates, perhaps left a bad taste on the mouth of Plato. Protagoras, we spoke about, remember, he was a sophist, and he was like the father of relativism, the famous quotation that what is true for me, what is true for me could be not true for you, and nothing happens. So, and Protagoras identifies virtue with knowledge, then Carmice about temperance, Lysis about friendship, and the Republic, that we will speak later on about it. So these are, again, a division. Perhaps in 50 years' time, 100 years' time, new papyrus are discovered, new pieces of evidence are discovered, and this division changes. It's not dogmatic, it's not absolute. No, it's a working process. But somehow, nowadays, it's the most accepted division of the dialogues of Plato. Then the second period, transition period, middle period, in which Socrates has already died, and Plato starts with his academy and begins to develop his own way of thinking. So we have here Gorgias, who was a sophist, he's a practical politician. Meno, who talks about how virtue can be taught. Euthydemus, against fallacies. Hippias the first, about the beauty. Hippias the second, whether it is better to do wrong voluntarily or involuntarily, so the relation between knowledge and moral responsibility. Cratylus, theory of language, and we said that Cratylus, he was a disciple of Heraclitus, so was the one who transmitted the teachings of Heraclitus to Plato. and Menexenus rhetoric. And finally, the third set, the third period of writing in the life of Plato, where that is the maturity period or late period. But as I said, sometimes it has been challenged and it has been said that perhaps some of these dialogues were written before. In any case, this is the conventional division. No? We have the Symposium that talks about beauty also, like Hippias, the Phaedo, that dialogue that report the last day of Socrates on life, and he talk about the immortality of the soul, the world of ideas. The Republic continues. First, in the previous period, was about justice. Now talks about the state. Phaedrus is a treatise about human love and mystical love. Thetetus, about knowledge and sense perception. Here we see also the influence of Heraclitus and Parmenides. Then Parmenides, about the ideal theory. The Sophist, about the ideas. And the Politicus, about political sciences. Also, we have the Philebus, the Timaeus, very important, about natural sciences, the Critias or Critias, about ideal agrarian state, the Laws and Epinomis, and letters 7 and 8. 8 also sometimes has some acceptance as authentic of the 13 epistles. So these are the entire, this complete set of dialogues as of today. So if today you go to a shop and you buy the books or the complete set of dialogues by Plato, they will give you all of these. Can also buy them separately. No? But what I mean is nowadays, the others that are not authentic will not come in this complete list or will come under the title Disputed Dialogues or Apocryphal Dialogues of Plato. So all these dialogues that I have mentioned, as I said, are devoted to the investigation of a single issue about which a conclusive result is rarely achieved. Excuse me, I need some water. So, they are devoted to a particular topic, and sometimes there's no conclusion. Sometimes the end of those books is just an open mark. It will continue, we can say. No, the debate will continue later on. No? This also shows the commitment of Plato to truth. When he feels that the result of that dialogue is not mature enough, is not conclusive enough, he leaves it like that, and will perhaps later on will retake that topic in another of his dialogues. So in the dialogues, as I said, Plato appears to address himself to particular topic. So he was never the explaining a complete system of philosophy. He was not a systematic philosopher as his disciple Aristotle would be later on. We will see this next class. Plato was just writing about this topic. Later on, his followers will be those who will divide Plato philosophy in logic, epistemologic, ethic, no? According to a systematic way of dividing it. But and this was done, I would say, mainly during the 18th and 19th century. As I said, there is the Socratic question or the Socratic problem to distinguish which are Socrates' ideas and which are Plato's ideas. Most probably, as I have said, those dialogues attributed logically to the youth of Plato are in which collect whatever Socrates taught, most probably. And in the others, also sometimes collect what Socrates thought, but has been also assumed by Plato as truth, assimilated by Plato. So agreed, there was an agreement between Plato and whatever Socrates thought, even when he wrote that dialogue, Socrates had already died. But this is the Socratic question, and you can find an enormous amount of literature, of works, articles, doctoral thesis discussing this, no? In this dialogue, or in this set of dialogues, who is speaking, Socrates or Plato? This is the Socratic problem, or Socratic question. In fact, it's not a problem, it's an enriching question that helped philosophy to progress and to go forward. Again, this division in periods that I have offered to you, I have shown you, that is the classical one nowadays, is not like with compartment divisions, no? No, is sometimes some of these dialogues could be placed also perhaps in the in a different period, and it will be also accepted. Now, in any case, we are not so much concerned whether this dialogue was written in the late period, middle period, or early period, but we are more concerned about what do the dialogues teach to us. And since Plato is the culmination of several centuries of Western philosophy, of that great introduction to Western philosophy, he took full advantage of whatever his predecessors taught. And there are mainly three topics that are the most important topics taught in the dialogues. One is the theory of knowledge as recollection. What does it mean, theory of knowledge as recollection? It means that for Plato, to know is reminiscence, to remember, because he will, for Plato, a human being is a soul united to a body due to a sort of a punishment. It's a sort of a fall from the higher state to the lower state. When human being was a pure soul, living in the cosmos noetos, in the supracosmos, was able to know the entire truth of everything, the entire world of ideas or forms. So when that human being assumed a human body, forgot everything that he knew, and he, through the effort of knowing, remembers. That is why Plato considered knowledge as recollection, reminiscence. First idea. Second important idea that we will explain later is that he conceived the soul as tripartite. The soul, not that he was talking about that we have three souls, three spiritual elements in our life, but that our soul has like three dimensions or three parts or three aspects: the appetite, the spirit, and the reason. So this is the second main idea running out through the dialogues of Plato, no? Theory of knowledge and recollection, conception of the tripartite soul, and the third, most important of all the teachings of Plato, is the theory of forms, theories of ideas. We will go deeper into it, but mainly is that if I see 100 trees in a park, well, all those trees are copies, imitations of the idea of trees, and that idea of form of tree exists in the cosmos noetos, in the supra world. That is why whatever exists in reality is not pure being, it's just an imitation, a copy. And that has a lot of consequences. That is why this is the most important teaching in the dialogues of Plato. Okay, now we'll go into the Republic. Before going into the Republic, just I want to ask if there is any question. Just if there is any question you can put in the chat, or any thing that you want to clarify. So I stop sharing for 2 minutes. If there is any point, any clarification, or you can ask now. You also will have some time at the end. Meanwhile, while you think of any doubt that you may have, I tell you, last lecture, one of you asked me, what happened with the eyes of the philosophers that appear in the painting by Raphael, the School of Athens, that seems to be all of them closed. So I check a little bit into it, and what I realize is a, we can say, an optic illusion somehow. When you look at them from far away, it seems as if they have all their eyes closed. But they, if you magnify on each of the characters, you will see that many of them are with their eyes wide open. Some of them, what is happening, they are looking down, or they are writing down, or they are reading something. So that appear as if they having the eyes closed. That was my research done by looking. But you can do it. You can Google, put School of Athens, and magnify each author, and you will. This will be the answer to that. Okay, so now going to the questions that some of you have put in the chat. Elaborate Plato idea of the soul. Okay, that if you allow me, also please repeat the three dimension of the soul. This, the three dimension is the appetite, spirit, and reason. But I will discuss in detail now during the second part of the talk, so we can wait a little bit till we reach that. Then the other question from Mr. George Cook from Sri Lanka. Good morning. Could you please go to the transition period, the middle that you refer to, and could you please differentiate between the first who in that section? Okay, the first two in that section. Yes, what I said is that nowadays the division of the dialogues of Plato is done according to a historical period. So there is a set of dialogues attributed to him that were written during his youth. That means when Socrates was alive, and more or less we can consider that all of those dialogues are not depict or transmit, especially what Socrates taught. And normally in those early dialogues, we don't find the deepest teachings of Plato explained. So there we don't have the tripartite division of the soul, the theory of the forms. All those things do not appear in the early dialogues, because basically still he's a young person, 28, 29. He's forming his own mind, like his own way of thought. So he's transmitting exactly what, mainly what Socrates taught. The second period is the transition, the period of in which Socrates has died, and Plato transmit ideas that Socrates taught. Sometimes are Socrates' idea that somehow Plato accepts, fully accepts. Others are ideas that, and others are ideas that Plato himself display and explain. And the third is the period of maturity, in which we find the explanation of the most important topics taught by Plato. For instance, the Republic is clearly a period from the period of maturity, even if perhaps one chapter already belongs to the to the second period. No? So in the period of maturity, we can say 100% the teachings of Plato, his own teachings on, especially on these issues of the knowledge as recollection, on the theory of the forms, the myth of the cave, the symbol of the line, etc., etc. And then you were saying, you are asking me if I understood your question. One second. Differentiating between the first two in that section. Okay, so I understand you refer to the to the difference between the early and the middle, no? So that is, if that was the question, the answer is that the early show us basically the teachings of Socrates that somehow accepted by Plato. But the second ones are mainly the teachings of Plato. Though many times you will find that some of these dialogues are in between, are from the early period and from the middle period. So this way, as every systematic way, is just to create a division, but all divisions are somehow artificially created, so can be modified with new development or with new findings of papyrus, etc. Okay. Sunil Kumar asks, Socrates, Plato, Aristotle all contribute the same theories. Which one is widely accepted during recent times or different from one another? Well, you will see, because still we have not spoken about Aristotle, that Aristotle agrees in many of the teachings, but disagrees with many others. In fact, the main topic of disagreement will be, and we will explain next class, is that Plato accepts the theory of form. So he accepts that what is real, real, really real, is whatever exists in the cosmos metos, in the outside our world. While Aristotle will say, no, whatever is real, real is on this world. He does not believe in a cosmos noetoi, a supracosmos with the world of ideas. That is the main difference between Plato and Aristotle. In ethics topics, there is similarity, but for instance, Aristotle challenged the teachings of Socrates that virtue and knowledge are equal, that sometimes gives the impression that Socrates affirms that when you know something, you are by default, you are acquiring that virtue. That if you know something, you will act virtually. But Aristotle will criticize in one of his books, saying, but you are forgetting the topic of moral weakness. Sometimes human man is weak, and even if he knows that it is good, he does whatever is wrong. So these are topics in which we can find different ideas, debate. So that is why it's not that Socrates, Plato, and Aristotle repeat the same. No, there is a continuity, an evolution from one something higher and higher and higher. But there are also some points of disagreement, some points of discussion. Okay, and now after this good question that you have asked, now we can go to the second part. So let's share the screen once again. So the Republic. The Republic, clearly the most famous book dialogue written by Plato, is quite long, and it covers many, many topics. As you see, the origin in Greek, the title of the book is Politeia, come from Greek, it means political system or constitution. Polis is city. That is why political philosophy is the philosophy about the city, about the government of the city. Politeia is the Greek word. In Latin, it was called res publica, the public things, the public concerns of human life. Thrasyllus, remember Thrasyllus was the head of the academy in the first century BC and is the one who arranged all the dialogues of Plato by way of tetralogies, group of four. So he gave the title On Justice. And the book, The Republic, mainly has two primary questions. So how it start this book. It starts with the dialogue about what is justice, questions and answers, the dialectic method. And the second is the just person happier than the unjust person? So these two topics, what is justice? And the relationship between the virtue and happiness. As we will see for these Greek philosophers, especially for Aristotle, the end of human action is happiness. In Latin, in Greek, it's called eudaimonia, happiness. But happiness is linked to the practice of virtue. So, when Plato began to discuss moral and political problems, he did it from his own theory of ideas, from his own theory that the world in which we live is not real, but the real world is the world that is beyond our world, in what he called the supra, the cosmos noetos, no? The cosmos, the world of ideas. So in his view, for Plato, ethics and politics are indivisible link to the natural order. So whatever is rule or whatever happens in society should be in agreement with our own nature. Remember when we spoke about the sophist, we mentioned the relationship between two concepts, nomos and physis. Nomos was the conventional order of society, the moral laws, and physis was our own human nature, the nature of the world, no? And whether there was, which was the relation between the law and nature, no? So, well, for Plato, it was clear that nomos, the laws, are a consequence of our own nature. That is why, from Plato and later on, the concept of natural law is developed. So, the Republic, that was written perhaps in the year 380 BC, is the greatest of all dialogues, and it has like three lines of discussion that are very much combined, a very artistic way, no? The ethical and the political, the aesthetic and mystical, and the metaphysical. Yeah, so we see mystics, so virtue will be a path to reach the supreme being, to reach salvation, ethical, how to behave on this earth, and metaphysical, how the ethics are linked or a consequence of our theory of being, in this case, the theory of ideas. So is it always better to be just than unjust? No? Is the primary question that Plato is posing at the beginning of the Republic. Now, to answer the question, Socrates takes a long way around. And before talking about what does it mean to be a just person, he talks about a good city. What does it mean to be a just city? A city in which justice is prevails. Keep in mind that when I mention city, polis, for the Greeks, a city was a state in itself. A city was a republic in itself. It was the concept of city-state. The entire Greece was full of city-states. And a person to be good has to be a good citizen. Somehow, for the Greeks, a person cannot be good outside his city. So Plato tried to analyze how to be good in the city is linked to the practice of virtue of of the citizens who live in that city. So he will, well, questions and answers, we will not enter, we don't have time, but from book first, second, third, even reaching, the academy has 10 books, it's divided into chapters, we can say 10 long chapters. So, but they are called books, each chapter. So from chapter 1 to chapter 4, Plato analyzed justice as a personal virtue to be practiced in that ideal, in that city, in the concrete city. So Socrates described the just society, the polis, from various points of view, epistemology, so it's talk about a way of knowledge, the theory of forms, etc., but always in relation to the life of the city. So a just society, a society in which there is justice, is analogous to a just person, a person who acts justly. So by way of a political analogy, that the characteristics of justice are clearly seen in a society than in an individual. So that is why, because Plato says, I can analyze the life of one person or two person or three person, but that will not teach me what a just society is. Instead, when I see what a just society is in its whole, then I can see what does a person needs to be a just person individually. So an account of a just society is given before the one of the virtuous people. That is why for Plato, education plays a very important role, because education will be the means to help people to be just, and by helping people to be just, we obtain the just society. So justice consists in a harmony that emerges when the various parts of a unit perform the function proper to them and abstain from interfering with the function of any other part. We saw that there is a tripartite division of the soul. There is this division also between this world in which we live and the cosmos. There will be a division among the people living in society. He will consider the merchants, those dealing with the economics part of society, the soldiers and the rulers. Well, all these divisions are always linked to virtues, to practical attitudes, to values. And there is an insistence that each one has to fulfill his own role. So harmony is ensured in the individual when the rational part of his soul is in command. This tripartite division of the soul, leads that when the rational part, that is the highest part of the soul, is the one that prevails, then man can act justly, and we achieve that harmony in which each one fulfills his own role. Plato develops his political theory, as I said, in close connection with his ethics. And the society is a natural institution, and man is a social animal. So this was the definition that was given by Plato and also by Aristotle. Man is a social animal. So man is an animal. Animal means a person who has he has movement. He moves by himself or by herself. He has a certain degree of knowledge. Well, but at the same time, that animal is rational. He has the intelligent, and that animal is social, lives in society. A man cannot live alone. I mean, there are cases in which a person can live, but normally those are extraordinary cases. Sometimes even we can find cases in which a child was kept in the wilderness and then he evolved almost like an irrational animal. So man needs to live in society. It's part of our essential characteristics. So when the Republic start in book one, the first person who appear in the dialogue is an old man. His name is Cephalus. He was a very rich man. He comes with his son, Polemarchus. But then those who enter and practically are the protagonists of the entire Republic are two of the children of Plato. No? Appear also Thrasymachus, who was a sophist. If you remember, when we spoke about the sophist, we talked about Thrasymachus, who spoke about that relation between the convention and nature. And he said, for instance, Thrasymachus defends the attitude of the tyrant. No? He says a tyrant of a person who has power by nature or by means of wealth or whatever, by his own talents, can do whatever he wants, because he has that natural power. No? So the laws goes to a second level, no, of importance. So what? So for Thrasymachus, justice is conventionally established by the strong in order that the weak will serve the interest of the strong. The strong, on the views of Thrasymachus, this sophist thinker, are better off disregarding justice and serving their own interest. This is why the Socrates and Plato rejected the teachings of the sophist, because there were people who were disregarding the value of truth, the value of human nature, etc. And logically, Plato cannot accept this way of understanding, and he rejects, and Thrasymachus leaves the dialogue. And then the brothers of Plato, Glaucon and Adeimantus, are those who are still discussing, discussing the teachings of Plato about the just society. They provide reasons why most people think that justice is not intrinsically valuable, but worth respecting only if one is not strong enough to get away with injustice. So they present justice as a way of defending a person, because you don't have enough power. So you need justice because otherwise you will be eaten by the most powerful person. Well, this sometimes happens, but clearly is not the ideal way of understanding how society has to evolve, has to function. So Socrates tries to show that justice relates to the just person's objective success, his own happiness, no? See, his own practice of virtues. So let's look in this slide that I more or less will find. First, a partial definition of justice. Justice is to do good to one's friends and harms. Oh, sorry. One second, I have to. Okay. Okay, I don't know, I have a problem to minimize the slide. I will try once again. Be patient. Sometimes these are. Okay, I think now we have reached again. Okay, so justice is to do good to one's friends and harm to one's enemies. And Thrasymachus is the one who, the sophist, who was saying, no, justice is the advantage of the stronger. So you see, it's a different opinion, a very selfish understanding of justice. So right and wrong are made by law, which is made by strong rulers for their own advantage. Yes, this happened many times, but it's not what a philosophy talks about, ideal society, not a utopian society, but an ideal society in which virtue can be practiced. People obey because of ignorance and weakness. This is the teachings of Thrasymachus. And the unjust ruler triumph because injustice is transformed as a virtue. No? A person who does whatever he wants is looked as a powerful person. So that injustice, does injustice lead to greater happiness than justice? Well, this is what this is being discussed. Of course, the answer will be no. But in book two and in book three, the dialogue of the Republic returns its focus on the person who aims to be happy. So, given this perspective, Socrates has to show that pursuing one's happiness favors being just. That means that to act justly is something good for a human being, consequently good for the society. Again, the brothers of Plato, Glaucon and Adeimantus, they challenge Socrates' position, because as you know, Plato never appears as talking in these dialogues, it's always Socrates. So Socrates suggests looking for justice as a virtue of cities before defining justice as a virtue of persons. So Socrates assumes that a just city is always more successful or happy than unjust city. If Socrates can explain how a just city is always more successful and happier than an unjust city by giving an account of civic justice, civic happiness, then he will have a model to propose for this relation between a person and between the society. So in the next, here you see Glaucon and Adeimantus, the brothers of Plato, men would like to do injustice and not to suffer it. But since few people can do that, the laws protect us from others inflicting injustices on us. So they maintain more or less the same ideas of Thrasymachus, that society is a way of defending ourselves. More than we practicing virtues, we protect from the evil actions of others. Political obedience is just to avoid injustice. Moral values are not related to things, but to fear. So the argument based on man's society distinction, but social justice is expression of individual justice. Society is a natural institution. So this is the conclusion. After having discussed all these issues and all the challenges put first by Thrasymachus, later on by Glaucon and Adeimantus, Plato will conclude that no, social justice is not just to defend ourselves. Yes, it is, but mainly it's an expression of individual justice, because society is a natural institution. So therefore, whenever we do things according to our own nature, then the product is positive. The product helps us to reach the final end of life. The origin of a city, we'll go forward in the book. Why do cities exist? Well, to the fact that no one is sufficient for himself, so it's clear, no human being can live alone. That is the difference between irrational animals and us. So the animals can exist on their own. The nature has provided them with enough resources to survive without human beings. But human beings, no, we need the help. So men, being in want of many things, gather into one settlement to satisfy their diverse needs. And to this common settlement, we give the name of city. Somehow, there is natural reason, but economic reasons, we can say. The growth of city also leads to war, because when you grow, sometimes you enter into conflict with other cities. All this is discussed in the Republic. So it's not that all wars have economic reasons, but yes, to some extent. And since there are many things to be done in any society, there is a need of division of labor. And he will talk about three classes of people. Here we have the guardians, but we have also the merchants and the rulers. And since there is a close relationship between a human being and the society, education plays a fundamental role. And gymnastic, music are very important. Poetry, as I said, he has a negative approach, but well, this is a topic to be discussed. Even if in the Republic, Plato considered that the poets and the dramatists should be out of the ideal state, it's not that he was against poetry, against art. Somehow, he was against those who are performing this, some poets or some playwriters who are more not concerned with truth. Basically, we can say that. Now, Plato recognized three classes of men, as I said, no, human beings in every society. First, we have the workers or merchant traders or the businessmen, those who deal with the material needs of every human being, of every person, and make up the bulk of the population. That happened in every city today, no? You look at Bombay, you look at Delhi, you look at Rome, Buenos Aires, any city in the world, well, most of the people are working in business, you know, multifarious kind of businesses. But then, not every human being is good person. You need to protect human beings, and then you need guardians. And the guardians consist of the two classes. First, the soldiers, who protect you against enemies, internal or external, always is needed. And then the rulers, the governors, the statesmen, those who manage the public affairs. As we know, Plato spoke about the philosopher king. For him, a person who has knowledge of reality, true knowledge of reality, is the one who should govern society. And that is the philosopher king. Now, the members of the three classes that are born with different interests, different talents, different qualities, each one is born for a particular task, and education helped them. That is why Plato elaborate a system of education that is different according to the type of citizen that he's educating. If you are preparing those who will be the guardians, different from those who will be rulers, different from those who will be merchants. And then the individual position of every person is not founded on heredity, but on qualities. So that is why Plato is against the tyrants, and in favor of people who know the truth to be the rulers in society. Now, the fact that he talks about three types of citizens is related to the three parts of the soul. Here we go to the question that was in the chat about what does it mean, this tripartite conception of the soul. Is it that he's speaking about three souls, different souls, three parts of the soul? What does it mean? Well, Plato, we have to say, to acknowledge that Plato's doctrine of the soul remains one of the perplexing puzzles in his philosophies. It's difficult, and there are many debates about which was the real knowledge or the real teachings of Plato about a tripartite soul. Here we see the influence of the Pythagoreans, the Orphic mysteries, etc. In the Dialogue of the Phaedo, the dialogue that collects, transmit to us the last day on earth of Socrates, there is a discussion about the immortality of the soul. So the fact that Plato taught, and Socrates taught, that the soul is immortal, and because of that he was so ready to give his life, Socrates, is akin to the fact that the world of idea, the world of form, is also immortal. Since the ideas are eternal, and they will never disappear, so the soul has also to be immortal in order to be able to know the world of ideas. And because all changes that happen on physical bodies are related to the world of ideas, to the world of forms. So there's a famous image that Plato uses in one of his dialogues in the Phaedrus, when he talks about a chariot, and in that chariot there is a charioteer that represents the intellect, reason, and that chariot is pulled by two winged horses. One represents the rational impulse, that is rationality, the will, and other represents the irrational passions, the appetites. So the appetite, the spirit, and the reason. So reason will be the part of the soul that prevails in the governing class. The appetite, the satisfaction of our sensitive passions, our desires, should be the part of the soul that prevails in the economic class. And the spirit or courage, the will, is the part of the soul that should prevail in the military class. So each part serves a purpose, and reason is the noblest part. So you see, it's not that the soul occupies different physical parts of our body, the head. No, is a way of speaking, but somehow he will talk about that strength, that force that is within each one of us, leading to act in one way or another. Again, it's very much puzzling, and there are a lot of discussion about what exactly Plato meant with this tripartite division of the soul. No? The idea of the charioteer driving the two horses, one spirit and the other sluggish, help us to understand that the three of them forms a unity. And the chariot tries to harmonize the opposite tendencies of the spirit or courage and the appetites. According to the Republic, every human soul that on this cosmos in which we live is always an embodied soul, always the soul does not exist by its own, but always united to a particular body, has these three parts: reason, spirit, and appetite. And they also symbolize the different social classes, as we have seen, that we can add also saying, no, that one is the productive class, that is the economic class, and Plato gives a symbolic representation in the human body, says the abdomen of the human body represents the productive class and corresponds to the appetite part of the soul. Then the protective class, the army, that is the chest protecting you, the guardians, and is linked to that spirit, to that courage. And then the head, the governing class, the rulers, the philosopher kings, that are governed by reason. And well, so this is the tripartite. No, one of the reasons why the Republic proposed this tripartite division is to appeal to reason, to spirit, and to appetite, to explain also broader patterns of human thought and action. No, so in the end, Socrates and Plato is saying that there are people who are governed, are ruled by reason, others by appetite, others by spirit. Of course, this is not like a wall. No, each human being can be governed by one or the other, and each human being combine the influence of these three parts of the soul. And virtue is when you, each human being, even if you are not a philosopher king, you have other profession, whatever is your role on life, but you have these three forces within you, no? The reason, the appetite, and the spirit. So this is, okay, he will apply this for the society, but this perfectly well applies to every human being. And we always have to try, following the teachings of Plato, to be governed by our own reason, because we always, there will be our appetites, and the appetite is not something negative. There are many needs, sensitive needs that we have to satisfy. And also, we need also that spirit, that courage to afford to face problems in life, etc., etc. So that is very clear. So it's a way of explaining, but that harmonic way of understanding human life is very much present in the teachings of Plato. So reason is characterized by its ability to track what is good. Through our reason, we know what is good for each part and for the soul as a whole. Reason is characterized by the desire for wisdom, to know the truth of everything. And these are not bifurcated means. So reason pursues not just what it takes to be good for the whole soul, for the entire soul, but also the wisdom that ensures that we can get it right, that we can do good things. The spirit, the second element, is more related to social preeminence, social honor, and the appetite seeks more material satisfaction for bodily urges, and also for wealth, money, you know. Money is not the end of life, but it's a means to achieve many things in life. So Oh, yes, if people, if your people is ruled only by appetite, well, will his desire will be only money, only success, only pleasure. So there is that harmonic and that effort to harmonize all these forces. This will give origin to what later on, and especially Aristotle will develop much more in his Nicomachean Ethics, to speak about the cardinal virtues. Aristotle offers a systematic analysis of the cardinal virtues, but already in Plato, we find the an explanation, although not in a very systematic way, but an explanation of these cardinal virtues, those fourth virtues that help our reason and our senses to go to fulfill the ethical aims, purposes of our life. And those four cardinal virtues are prudence, temperance, fortitude. Fortitude, temperance, and there's one more that will come to my mind now. So these four virtues are essential because one rules our sensitive appetites, our reason, prudence, and justice. Sorry, now came to my mind, no? The four virtues. So temperance, fortitude, justice, and prudence. And prudence will be, in Aristotle, the virtue that guide us, help us to act accordingly in every moment of our life. But that will be especially developed by Aristotle. But what I wanted to say is that in Plato, we have already a good picture of these four cardinal virtues. For instance, Plato believed in the imperishability, the immortality of the soul. Physical objects come and go, but being is constant. The theory of forms is something constant. He gives some proof that the soul is immortal that can be useful. Perhaps they are not completely perfect, this proof, but conclusive, this proof, but are quite good. One is he believes in reincarnation, so it is reasonable to suppose that this cycle way of society, of nature, applies also to the soul, that the soul also, well, is immortal. This idea of knowledge as recollection leads to think that, well, when the soul lives not in union with a body, that soul, being immortal, was able to know all the truth of all the ideas. The soul is always contemplating the eternal forms, therefore is immortal. And somehow all the explanation about change, about the one and the many, about changing things that are given by Heraclitus, Parmenides, are not convincing for Plato, and therefore he affirms not that our knowledge is not reliable, but mainly that our soul is immortal, and therefore the true knowledge is the one that we acquire in before the incarnation, we can say, before we have an embodied soul. Plato, in the book 5 of the Republic, will talk something that was very famous. He proposed, not for everyone, but for some of the, for instance, for the ruling class, a community of wives and children. This is not equal to promiscuous free love, no? No, but he, for the upper classes, the ruler class and the military class, thought that the wives has to be living all together, so they were not forming a family, and the children are not educated by the family, but are educated by the state, by the society. Well, this is, of course, not accepted by everyone, and we cannot be sure that that was the final idea of Plato, but logically, not everyone accept. I don't accept that way of understanding society. But clearly you see how in Plato, human being was subordinated to the needs of the society. That is why sometimes it is said that Plato had a communist approach to social life, because he consider that the state should control marriage of the guardians and the soldiers and the ruling people. No? Well, now going to the theory of forms, that is a very important topic in Plato, also very well explained in book number 5. We discover ideas. We read first. They are not invented by us. Ideas or forms in Plato refer to the objective content or reference of our universal concepts. They refer to an objective essence, source of goodness and beauty in all particular things that are good or beauty. So the rulers should be philosophers, we said, no? According to Plato, because they know that even if there are many things called by the same name, there must be some reason, some form, some idea by which all of them, even if different, they are the same. So these are the ideas. Of course, the theory of ideas of Plato is difficult to grasp in its full implication, but it is clear that the ideas exist outside the human mind. Plato was not saying that the ideas are within my mind. No, the ideas exist somewhere else, in the cosmos noetos. And our mind has to know them, but these ideas exist beyond our the cosmos, beyond our mind. So in the Republic, Plato explains that to a plurality of individuals with a common name corresponds an idea of form. So there are many things that are beautiful, so there is one idea of beauty. There are many things that are good, there is one idea of good. There are many things that are just, there is one idea of justice. There are many things that are mountains, there is an idea of mountain. There are many things that are elephants, there is an idea of elephant. That is what Plato teaches. There is a place beyond this human world in which all the ideas exist eternally and immaterially. And whatever exists in this world that in which we live, it is real, but are just copies, okay? Copies of those original ideas. So the real are the ideas, while the copies of the particular objects of this world are not really real, are just imitations. And that is why sometimes if we don't ascend to the knowledge of the form, if we don't achieve that, then we finish believing that the real is the world, the material world in which we live. That is what Plato says. So, the physical world that we perceive with our senses is in constant flux, movement. So, the knowledge that we derive from the knowledge of the physical world is variable, and while the knowledge that we achieve from knowing the forms is a knowledge that is eternal and changeless, because the ideas are eternal and changeless. Each form is the pattern of a particular category of things in this world. So they are, as I said, a form or form of idea are synonymous. The Greek words that Plato used can be translated into idea, because he used the word eidos. So that is why sometimes it's translated in as idea. But since ideas apply to something that is in my mind, philosophy uses more the word form, F-O-R-M, form, to as that ideal object that exists in the cosmos noetos, to differentiate from the ideas that are in my mind. So the forms are ideas that exist outside my mind. And the things of this world are only imperfect copies of those ideas. So ideas of forms in Plato refer to the objective content or the reference of our universal concepts. Each concept that we have in our mind refers to an objective essence. And that objective essence is each one of the forms, each one of the ideas. Okay. So here you see in this table, you see the structure of society, the role of each member of that society, which is the element that should prevail within that person, and the virtue that should be practiced. So the society in the Republic, you have the highest, the statesmen, who are the guardians of societies. Then you have the armed forces, auxiliaries, and the civilians, the artisans, merchants, etc. So which is the role of the statement? To govern, and for that, to be a philosopher. Only a philosopher can govern. Why? Because the philosopher is the one who has acquired knowledge of the forms. And since he has acquired knowledge of the forms, he's the one who knows how to rule a society. The armed forces, their purpose is to defend us, so men of action, and the other to satisfy our needs. So the three elements, the three parts of the soul that should prevail is reason, spirit, and appetites, but in a harmonic way. And that means that each one of them have to put into practice a particular virtue: wisdom, courage, and temperance. As I said, these three virtues that Plato mentions, wisdom, courage, and temperance, will be developed later on by Aristotle in his treatise, his Nicomachean Ethics, talking about the cardinal virtues. And he adds the virtue of justice. Wisdom, he will call it prudence. Courage, he will call it fortitude. And temperance, use the same name, but always together with the virtue of justice. So the ideas exist apart in a transcendental world, and they are related with the world, the objects of this world, which are sensible copies, participation in the ideas. The concept of participation, that is one idea of which we participate, every object participates, is a very important idea in Plato, and a very important idea that will enter into philosophy throughout the centuries. So the main problem is how to solve the relations between the idea and the object, between the forms and the object. No? So Plato will talk that there is a principle of unity. And in fact, in this simile of the line, so he distinguished, like, okay, there are two worlds, the world, a world that is the intellectual world, the world of ideas, and the visible world, the physical world in which we live. In the intellectual world, we know the truth, episteme, we know we get real knowledge of whatever exists. In this visible world in which we live, we have only doxa, opinion, because we cannot know the real truth. This is like a line, no? An ascending line. So if we go from ignorance, that is at the bottom of this table, first we get conjecture. We began to say, okay, perhaps this, perhaps that. So, and this is knowledge of images, shadows, reflection. When I see, I can be waiting for a train, and then from the show, a train is coming, but is it going to my station or not? Do I have to wait till now? Now it's clear. I know that this train is going to this station or to the other station. So I pass from conjecture to belief, and then to understanding. Finally, to noesis, that is pure reason. So the Plato gives the simile that knowledge is like a line, ascending line, from ignorance to knowledge. And I pass through these mental states. First, a conjecture, I guess about this or that. Second, a belief. Third, I understand. Finally, I have the perfect knowledge. I know that the real knowledge, that is, I know the form, I know the idea, the archetypes. So this simile of the line is very famous, and they depict the characteristics of the philosophers who know the philosophers, those who reach knowledge of the truth, and then therefore they can practice virtue. The philosopher knows that which gives value and meaning to everything else in the world, knows the good. The good is identified with the sun sometimes, that illuminates all the objects of the world. So Socrates will explain the form of the good with the image of the sun, as I said, no? And to do this explanation, he developed the allegory of the cave, something very famous in the teachings of Aristotle. The allegory of the cave. It rests on the belief that the soul is not only immortal, but pre-existent as well. So in Plato, epistemology and ontology go together. In one of the dialogues, the Tetetus, he refutes the teachings of Protagoras, the teaching of that sophist, that knowledge is self-perception. No? He says, no, knowledge is not self-perception. Knowledge is knowledge of the forms, knowledge of the truth. And this is what he developed in the Republic. And he said he would give different degrees of knowledge based on a hierarchy of being. So perception is not the whole of knowledge. Even within his own affair, perception is not knowledge. So let's see the allegory of the cave. The allegory of the cave, we find it in the seventh book of the Republic, and shows the ascent of the mind from lower sections of the simile of the line to a higher in an epistemological form. No? So here what we see. On the left, we find a group of prisoners, a group of human beings, and these prisoners represent the majority of mankind. And they are in the state of akasia, looking at shadows of reality. We go up, remember, akasia at the bottom of the table is those who are in the world of opinion, the level of conjecture, akasia. Perhaps nowadays that we are much informed about results of elections in various countries, we see how first, with the media, we are at the level of akasia, conjectures, polls. This politician can gain, this can win, this can lose, but from the first results to the final result, there is a big difference. So the same happened with every knowledge. No? So the prisoners are in that in that place, representing the state of akasia, and they can only look at shadows. The problem is that they believe that those shadows are the real world. At the entry of the cave, there is a fire. So, and there is a raceway flanked by a screen concealing those passing along the road. So you have a raceway that at least is surrounded by a screen that so does not allow you to see everything in detail. And then you see objects passing along the road, no? But you cannot see very clear because the prisoners are not looking at the fire, not looking at the sun. No? But the prisoners are chained from birth and their back is facing the entrance to the cave. So the only thing that they can see is a wall on which the shadows are thrown. This is very interesting, no? So imagine, no? The prisoners, behind the prisoners, we have the raceway. And there, all the objects of the world, animals, mountains, vegetables, virtues, everything, continuously passing along the road, illuminated by the fire. But the prisoners cannot see that raceway and the objects illuminated by the fire, because they are chained from birth and they are looking at the wall on which the shadows are thrown. That is what the allegory of the cave represents, that the majority of humankind can only believe that whatever exists in this world is true. Therefore, for them, the reality is what they see on earth, but they don't know that there exists another world, that is the world of forms and world of idea, and that the shadows that they are looking at are pure imitations of that reality. So now if one prisoner escapes, this is narrated in the Republic, he will grow accustomed to the light. First, he will be like blinded by so much light, but then little by little will get accustomed to the light. And then he will be able to look at the concrete sensible objects. And if he perseveres in his efforts and manages to come out of the cave into sunlight, by following the ascending symbol of the line, finally he will see the world that is illumined by the sun, and everything will be real. Then he will realize, oh, I was deceived till now. Now I know that the real world is this one. So that prisoner, and that is who reached that level, the statement, no? The philosopher. So he achieved the state of noesis. He achieved that the real good, the ideal of good, is the idea that illuminates all the other ideas. And that is through education. So, but what happened is that Plato tells us that then that prisoner will say, oh, I have to go back to meet my fellow prisoners to tell them that what they are considered to be true is not true. So he goes back, but the prisoners do not believe him. They say, you are telling lies. You are telling utopian ideas. We don't believe you. For us, the real world is this one, what we have in front of our eyes, the shadows that we have in front of our eyes. So these are the people who are governed by their own passions, by their own appetites, so they cannot make the effort to know the truth, and ends finishing knowing that the whatever is in front of their eyes is the truth. That is why Plato developed that educational system to help people to know the truth. And he developed sort of subjects to be studied, teaching sciences to be taught, etc., etc. We are already reaching the end. We have to leave some minutes for questions. But the form of the government also, in Plato, we find the democracy, the oligarchy, and the democracy or aristocracy. Aristocracy is the government of the philosophers. Those who, for Plato, an aristocrat is a person who achieved virtue in his life. Timocracy is more a sort of a military rule, but he promotes a sort of a benign military state. He does not promote tyranny, but yes, he thinks that the presence of the armed forces in government are important because they will control the other members of society. The oligarchy is the state of government in which the merchant princes are the one ruling, so those who have economic power, and somehow they are not interested in the good, in the justice of the society, but only in their own interest. And democracy, the government ruled by the people, but somehow is a government subjected to an irresponsible will. He does not have a positive understanding of democracy. For him, the perfect or the best way of government is the aristocratic way of government with the help of a benign military state. With this, we finish just in the book 10, he mentions some myth, but that is the myth, eschatological myth of Er, but we don't enter into it. Two other important dialogues in Plato are the Symposium, in which he deals with the topic of love. So he will speak about physical love, human love. He will use the word Eros, the Greek word of Eros, but that physical love also has something positive that following the path of the theory of form can help a person to ascend and to reach the mystical love or the divine love. So there is a path that it is explained in the dialogue of the Symposium, by in which he talks about the ladder of love, from which from purely erotic love we can ascend to a mystical love. And another dialogue is the Timaeus, that was very important because it was one of the few dialogues translated into Latin. So when Greek was not anymore the common language in the Roman Empire and was replaced by Latin. So the Timaeus became well known by the medieval philosophers and talks about creation, the idea of God creating this physical world through a demiurge. And this was a very important dialogue that somehow maintained the interest on Plato throughout the centuries, particularly through the Middle Ages. No? The Timaeus is a poetic account of the universe. And well, it's 5 minutes to 12, so we better finish here. As I said, this is just a brief introduction, the tip of the iceberg in the philosophy of Plato. So thank you very much. Now, if there is any question, I stop sharing the screen.
Thank you so much, sir. Basically, now the subject, now as far as we understand, it is a vast subject, but still you have tried to cover it in for us in just 2 hours, which is very nice for us, because to understand the philosophy in detail, it requires a lot of effort, it requires a lot of study and the guidance of the teacher. But whatever you have explained, help us to understand the beginning and to just enter into the philosophy. So as you mentioned that it is the tip of iceberg, but definitely I hope that some of the participants, they will definitely will like to learn the philosophy in detail. So as we are having this lecture series, the introduction to philosophy, after having the introduction, definitely some of us would like to learn the philosophy in detail. So thank you so much for the excellent session. And I request all the participants, if you have any question, you can raise your hand or you can type your question in the chat box. Yes, sir. I think there is one question. How can we use Plato's philosophy on human soul in understanding human behavior with respect to psychology?
Okay. Well, as I said, no, Plato first believes in the existence of the soul, so believes that in every human being there is a spiritual element, and he's a dualistic, so for him, the real human being is the soul. The body is a union that is an accidental union due to a fall, because for Plato, the souls live in the cosmos noetos, in the suprasensible cosmos world, and due to, he has not given any particular explanation, but sometimes there is the idea of a sort of a metaphysical fault, perhaps, or fall, that soul ended united to a particular body that is called an embodied soul, and through philosophy has to ascend to get rid of that material body. That is why the soul has those three elements, and that he offers that tripartite division of the soul, no? Reason, appetite, and will, because there are like three forces within us that only if harmonically they go together, we will reach the end of life, that will be to go back to the world, to the cosmos netos for Plato. So these different three parts of the soul clearly are linked to our psychological behavior, because in every human being feels that interaction, sometimes opposition or struggle of those forces within him or within her. So the philosophy of Plato helps that human being, help us to behave in a way that we can achieve the final end of life. I think I see that the relation with psychology.
There is one more question. We'll take it as a last question. By now, we understand that Indian philosophies are for liberation of the soul, and Western philosophy leads to live a better worldly life. Can we say that?
But now we start Asian philosophies. Hard for you, so at least to live. Well, to some extent, yes. To some extent, no. Because history of in Western philosophy, we have a difference, quite a difference of philosophers. No? It is true that Indian philosophy is very much united to that task of achieving liberation of the soul. So that is true. And in Western philosophy, not always that effort is present. In Plato, somehow philosophy is a way of liberating, because for Plato, our present reality of embodied souls is due to a fall. So through philosophy, we can ascend and get rid of this embodied soul by contemplating the truth of the forms. So in Plato, we find that philosophy is also a spiritual path, a path for liberation. In Aristotle, not so much, because Aristotle will not deal with mystical issue, will not deal much with liberation of the soul. Aristotle focused more on the essential aspect of the present beings, of the existing beings. And in fact, we will see that for him, soul is not an eternal, but souls exist together with the body, but that will be for next class. So in Aristotle, we can say Aristotle is not a science, a philosophy is not a path for salvation or liberation of the soul, but it's a path to achieve happiness in life. So this, I can say, yes, live better a worldly life. For Aquinas, the same. Aquinas will be more on the line of Plato, although with different backgrounds, but the idea of knowledge of philosophy united to theological knowledge to achieve the final end of life. So even though I will agree that in most or in many Western philosophers, the aim is to achieve a wealthy life, there are many other also Western philosophers in which there is the idea of liberation of the soul. But not always, we have to understand that not all Western philosophers understood in the same way liberation of the soul.
Thank you so much, sir. And I think it is time to stop. It is 12 o'clock. So thank you so much for today's session. And I request all the participants to join again for the fourth session on the coming Thursday, that is 12th November. So we seek to gain more and more knowledge from this lecture series. Thank you so much, Dr. Iturbe. And I thank all the participants on behalf of KJ Somaiah Institute of Dharma Studies to join this lecture series. Thank you so much.
Okay, thank you very much, Rudraksha. Thank you to all the participants. And just in case any of you would like to discuss something else or needs to clarify something, feel free. I will leave you my email ID. You can send me an email asking this point you didn't understand. Okay, well, of course, the open session are sometimes the best moment to discuss this point, but sometimes doubts come later on and we don't know how to answer. So I just leave my email ID, Mariano at the rate of somaiah.edu. So you can contact me if you need. So thank you very much. We meet again on Thursday.